Today's session is titled Hands-On Perspectives, Deploying FIDO-Based Modern Authentication Solutions. Our moderator is Kayvan Alikhani, lead technologist for Identity, RSA.
Thank you so much. And thank you for attending today's session. I'm really going to start off by giving a bit of a historic perspective around FIDO Alliance, provide a perspective on what its mission is, and then turn it over to our esteemed panelists to take it from there. FIDO Alliance is a six-year-old organization with a very straightforward mission, providing strong and simple authentication with a byproduct of hopefully replacing or getting rid of passwords altogether. As a person who's been working on strategy for RSA and as the board representative to FIDO, I can tell you that our customers and users, we constantly see this tug of war between convenience and adequate security. And when it comes to FIDO, trying to address that they don't have to be at odds with each other. So from one side, FIDO takes advantage of public key cryptography, which means no shared secrets. From the other side, as a result of the public key crypto mechanism, credentials never leave the device as part of authentication, so they never cross the wire. And the result of this is that you ultimately eliminate the chance of successful phishing attacks or man-in-the-middle attacks, a pretty substantial outcome. From a convenience perspective, you're talking about the possibility of using multiple biometric methods, face, voice, fingerprint, or simple gestures to authenticate the user. So actually, it's music to the ears of the user from a convenience perspective as well. The organization today has over 250 members with over 300 certified solutions. RSA is one of those certified solutions in the market, and the FIDO reach today is available to over 2 billion users worldwide. Today, if you deploy our product as an example, you can take advantage of FIDO U2F natively, and you can see that all the certified products within the FIDO solution, certified solutions as well. We have today a set of security practitioners within verticals, healthcare, finance, and I guess Google, what vertical would you?
Everything.
Everything. Every vertical. And we have the executive director of the FIDO Alliance to provide more perspective on worldwide deployments. And we're going to go to the panelists and ask them to please introduce yourself, starting with Abbie, and tell us what is your perspective around FIDO from a standards perspective, and from why and how are you thinking of deploying within your organization?
Okay. Thank you. So my name is Abbie, and I work for Aetna. My job, Aetna is a healthcare provider, insurance. My job is to eliminate reliance on username, password. This is what I'm hired to do. We're working internally on a very aggressive project now. It's called Next Gen Authentication. The objective is you sign on with your device and we know who you are. It's a continuous risk-based type authentication system that enables you to access Aetna services in a consistent manner, regardless of your abilities. We work with consumers and clients with various disabilities and other stuff, and our solution has to be adaptable. We cannot be stuck in one form, or, you know, we had to support a wide range of people at different stages in their life interaction with us. The design policy was, you know, consistent way of interacting with Aetna regardless of the application or the access device. You authenticate in a way that's expected, and it's easy to use and secure, so with minimum impact on the end user. The use with FIDO, FIDO is an important building block. It's a standard-based system that enables me to have a unified client to talk to. At the server side, there's this FIDO server, that's fine, but I can add extra analytics to keep the risk-based analysis for authentication in a way that's transparent to the end user. So FIDO become a building block for simplicity, scale, and you know, support. So it give me continuity of a hard system to crack. It's not easy to replace the username password. It has a lot of challenges, and complications. It's technological, but also cultural. A lot of the issues that you have, it's how can you change your internal business to start adopting a new solution that's more secure and save the money, but at the end of the day, it requires change in the actual way of how they do business. This is another part of the challenge of deploying a solution. So I'll stop here.
Thank you. So hello, I'm Christiaan Brand. I'm a product manager for strong authentication efforts over at Google. Google was one of the founding members of the U2F, or Universal Second Factor Working Group within the FIDO Alliance. And we aim to standardize strong second factor authentication on the web. For those of you that don't know, FIDO U2F, or Universal Second Factor, is a little different from other popular second factor solutions in that it's able to provide protection against phishing threats. A U2F authenticator is usually a small, discrete device that plugs into a device, to a phone or a PC or a computer or a MacBook, using either USB, connecting through near field communication, NFC, or using Bluetooth low energy, something that we've added to the specification only recently. Now, in addition to providing the web property with the assurance that a U2F authenticator, or security key, as you might have heard the term used, security key as we call them, was present during the authentication, the security key is also able to validate that you're on the correct web property. And I think that's kind of the real big differentiator, as I stated earlier. There's three separate use cases for U2F over at Google. The first use case is internal authentication. FIDO U2F forms the basis of all authentication internally for Google employees. You're required to get access to pretty much everything inside the company, any electronic resource. Secondly, we've also enabled security keys for consumers. So anyone with a Google account, any consumer can add a security key to their account for an additional level of protection. And then lastly, only recently, actually about 14 days ago, we've added another feature on the enterprise side called security key enforcement. The big difference there is that in the past, security key was an option. You could add it together with additional second step or two-step verification mechanisms. Now we allow administrators to enforce the use of security keys. That's a very important differentiator, because only when you enforce only FIDO authentication solutions can you really protect your employees against the malicious actors and threats on the web. So this really provides the best level of protection against phishing attacks today. And Verizon recently published a report on data breaches. I think it's the 2015 one that I'm thinking of, where they said that over two-thirds of security incidents in 2015 was somewhere or another password related. So I think this is very opportune, and everyone should take a look at what we've done from a FIDO perspective.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Will Bennett. I'm the Interim Chief Information Security Officer for USAA. For those of you that aren't familiar with USAA, we're a financial services company for the military and their families. We provide a full range of products and services to the military and their families. So when I looked at the FIDO spec or the FIDO standard, one of the things that really stuck to me, we've implemented two-factor authentication. We rolled it out about 7 years ago to our membership, so we actually got a lot of experience and a lot of bruises and a lot of scar tissue in rolling it out. But we most recently looked at the FIDO standard, and we said, this is a really good way in which to standardize across our entire environment, so it really aligned with our vision. I am the one person on the panel who has not deployed FIDO yet, but it is in our strategic roadmap, and so there are things that we are working on currently to get us there. But it really boiled down to the vision and having a simple and secure experience for not only our members, but also our employees internally. And the other thing, too, that it's standards-based, so it's not a proprietary solution, which is another advantage for us to look at this solution as well. And then, again, it's just aligned with our strategy overall to deploy multi-factor authentication, not only to our membership, but also to our employees.
So as Kayvan mentioned, my name is Brett McDowell. I'm currently the executive director of the FIDO Alliance. So it's my job to try to coordinate all the companies that have an interest in this technology, to help facilitate consensus and get these standards built, and then also oversee the development of programs that allow the rest of you to take advantage of this technology in the market, like testing and certification so that you know that the products interoperate, educational materials, branding programs, and the like. What I'm doing here on the panel today is kind of representing everyone who we couldn't fit on the panel. There are a lot of companies who have deployed FIDO, you know, even more companies right now that have FIDO certified implementations. And so when we do get to Q&A, I welcome any questions you have. While I can't speak on behalf of any one company, I probably get the opportunity to talk to more companies than anyone else about what they're doing with FIDO, and I can at least provide some informed general answers to your questions.
Thank you so much. So for those of you who've been under a rock or have been visiting from another country, we just went through a presidential election in the United States, and during the election process, there was a, let's call it a DNC hack attack that resulted in unveiling a set of emails. And when root cause analysis was done, it turned out that it was not sophisticated at all. It was a very simple, you need to reset your password email. The user proceeded to reset their password, providing their password to the phishing attacker, which then took over their mailbox, revealing thousands and thousands of emails. So, question for you, Christian. Can you tell me what steps you actually took, key steps you took during the FIDO deployment, and what is your perspective for the enterprise going forward? Having Google now as an enterprise solution supporting U2F, what is your perspective, what is the advice that you give from that perspective?
Right, so I think firstly, as you mentioned, right, we've also done a study, we've actually published a white paper on this. If you look at the types of attacks that we see out there, even with all the work that's going into education and trying to convince users that they should always check URL bars and do a bunch of things to make sure they're on the right websites, about a half of all users will still fall for a sophisticated phishing attack. So this is still a problem. And we believe that we can really move the needle if we're able to address phishing on the web. So in terms of steps that we took, I think if you think about the deployment that we've done, there's kind of really two big pieces to it. The first piece is we had to enable platform support, right? So because we have a major browser, Chrome, we have a major mobile operating system, Android, the first piece of the puzzle was to ensure that FIDO works on these platforms and that it's supported. The benefit there is once we've done that piece, anyone that wants to deploy FIDO solutions can obviously build on this. So that was kind of the first piece. And the good news here today is that work is done. So anyone that wants to deploy FIDO, specifically U2F-based solutions today, as long as you're using Chrome as a browser, as a client, you're able to piggyback and work off that support that we've already provided. So that was kind of the first step. And then the second step was kind of providing the internal support. So for Google as a sign-in mechanism to not only support a two-step verification mechanism of SMS and maybe oath-based one-time password support, as we've rolled out with Google Authenticator, adding kind of the second step, adding the U2F support in there. I think the positive side again there is many vendors at this conference that have support for FIDO servers to integrate that into your own sign-in solutions. And on the other side, we've also open sourced a FIDO U2F server. It's available on GitHub. You can search for it that you can then use to implement FIDO U2F in your own environment pretty easily. So many different options available, many different ways of implementing that yourselves. And as I said, we're kind of hoping here today in the room that we get more support, right? More client support is always better. But I think today with Chrome, with Android, with many other big organizations that have joined FIDO, that we're heading in the right direction here. So support will only be increasing as time goes along.
Very good, thank you. Looking at FIDO as a overall component of an identity and access management infrastructure, obviously we're talking about a puzzle and FIDO solves an important piece of that puzzle. So Abbie, I wanted to ask, how are you making FIDO work with the rest of your identity management, access management solution? How has that been going from a deployment perspective?
Yeah, so thank you for asking. One of the big problems that we face from Aetna, it's people buy insurance, they come in on November when you have to enroll, username, password, your credential and you buy your insurance, and then you go. If you're not sick or you're trying to interact with us on a day-to-day basis, we don't see you till next November. So from a perspective, this is the perfect customer, you know? Thank you very much for your support. But what happened next year when you come in? The first thing they do is they pick up the phone and do a password reset. On the automation part, you know, the current password reset that is done, it uses KBA-based approach, you know? Basically, we challenge you, date of birth, your favorite city, stuff like that, which is really weak. The business model has worked in this model for some time because it makes things easy. We want you to enroll at the end of the day. We don't want to make the enrollment hard. But the identity vetting validation become very hard for us. We have to take risk. In most cases, it's okay because if you want to fill a prescription or file a claim, we can catch the fraud later in the business process. But once you start linking to HSA and other health savings account, now you have access to a banking information. The risk become much higher because if we let you in, you can get access to transfer money. So this is part of the issues that we started prompting us to less rely on username and password and go find the stronger authentication mechanism. So FIDO fits into the equation because it enables us to really like fingerprint you and get to know you and then eliminate the call the first thing that you do next year. But for existing customers, it means to adopt FIDO, we needed to have a change because most of the time when you come in like through a plan sponsor, we get information about you, but the information is not good enough to do a good assurance password reset. We don't know precisely your email, the email address is not validated, your phone number is not validated, which is some ingredients that you need to work within a FIDO-based solution to do a proper identity vetting. So enroll you and your device properly. I need to make sure it's you. If you have a stolen or spoofed credential, you can still enroll within FIDO because the assumption is the identity vetting is done on the back end. On the relying party side. So, you know, this is the challenges that become. How can we work within a community to do online identity vetting in a way that enable us to deploy FIDO securely and really take advantage of that? What happens if you lose your device, you know, of your phone? Currently, if we don't have a system of someone vouching on your behalf, we're gonna have to depend back on a username, password for you to get back, to re-enroll you back again. It becomes the chicken and the egg process. So, you know, we need to have more a change in the internal policies to support the FIDO-based solution because the identity vetting and the identity bootstrapping, how you bootstrap someone into the system is changing. And you need to work that within the environment, within your business, and this is not easy. You have business that have done business in this fashion, this is the process, this is the flow for years. You need to convince them why they need to change. And then you need to do it in a way that's really smart enough where you don't impact the customer. At the end of the day, if your measurement for success is how many people enrolled per day, you cannot affect that number because the business will come back to you with a big hammer. You stole my enrollment and I cannot be the bad guy. I have to be the good guy. So you have to work within all of those constraints.
So that's interesting. FIDO, a volunteer organization, so if any of these problems or any of these challenges resonate with you, please join the FIDO Alliance and contribute to solving the problem. In fact, within FIDO Alliance, there are different working groups, various working groups, one specifically trying to address what Abbie mentioned from the recovery, enrollment, and tie into those processes perspective within the FIDO Alliance as part of the deployment at scale overall umbrella. So that's one of the concepts we're following on. And thank you, Abbie, for that. So we've heard from Google and obviously from Aetna from a vertical perspective. I want to say that FIDO, for the most part, has been taken a horizontal approach, not specific to a vertical. But Will, what I was going to ask you a twofold question. One is, what do you see in terms of compliance or the general issues that are specific to the banking industry? And secondly, you already had 2FA. Why did you roll that out, and why are you not considering FIDO with that already in place?
Right, good question. So being a being a bank, USAA is a $70 billion bank. We're the 10th largest issuer of credit cards. So obviously we have a lot of things that we have to consider when we're rolling out any type of technologies. But there are a lot of regulatory and compliance items that we do have to adhere to. So we really looked at FIDO as a way of helping us standardize that across our entire portfolio of products and services. And so in doing so, you know, yes, we've already deployed multi-factor authentication, you know, many, many years ago, but we really have a stack of different solutions with different proprietary vendors, et cetera. So we looked at the FIDO spec as a way in which we could standardize across that and make it interoperable to where we could plug and play pretty much any vendor that we wanted to. So that's really a couple of things that we looked at. The other thing too is when we deployed, FIDO was really not around at the time. So that was another reason that we were pressing forward with our current strategy to deploy. And unfortunately, if I were sitting in the audience today, I would take a strong look at it because I didn't have that opportunity, you know, when we did roll out multi-factor authentication many years ago. So
thank you so much. And so Brett, as you mentioned, this is a representative panel of the deployments that have happened so far. Can you give us a glimpse at more worldwide deployments that have happened and what's happening from a deployment perspective at the larger scale?
Sure, Kayvan. So the Alliance is actually comprised of companies from around the world and pretty equally. This is not a very US-centric organization at all. In fact, there's so much activity happening in Asia, I'd almost say that the Alliance kind of skews to the Asian continent right now. And that's also true of deployments. So I'll mention a few that are happening in Asia that are of interest. BC Card, who is the most common, you know, largest market share payment card company in Korea, they have deployed FIDO in a few different ways. They have their own payment app. You can think of that kind of like a PayPal app or Square. It's their own wallet service for payment. And they've done voice authentication for that. They've added voice authentication. And I know that they were going to integrate fingerprint after that. So I actually started with voice for that one. But they're going to support multiple modalities. In addition to that, they've added FIDO authentication, a FIDO authentication flow to their Samsung Pay solution in Korea. So Samsung Pay, generally speaking around the world, doesn't require a FIDO component. But BC Card added FIDO to get increased security from that deployment and increased, telemetry, you know, consistency across all their different channels. One thing that FIDO being a standard gives you is that consistency across all your channels, all your modalities. You basically have one way of doing authentication, which is the asymmetric cryptographic way. Another interesting one in Korea is called K-FIDO. So Korea is one of those countries, you know, of which there are many that have e-signature laws and a PKI system for signing and confirming transactions legally in the country. Now that pre-existed FIDO, but what they've done is they've opened up. They used to actually require a very specific client-side way of unlocking your e-signature. They've deprecated that and opened up for people to use anything they want for that client-side authentication to your PKI flows. And FIDO was coming into the market at the same time they did that, and so companies like Crucial Tech and Samsung and LG have all kind of jumped on the FIDO bandwagon, and now we're seeing that the certificate authorities in Korea are building a FIDO solution, so a FIDO client and a FIDO server that first authenticates the user account to the CA, and then the CA will do the PKI signing that they would have done before. So that's another kind of interesting deployment. But then in general, probably the biggest news recently was Facebook, who rolled out FIDO as a second factor recently, as Google has, so following that deployment. Salesforce, GitHub, Dropbox, these are other live deployments in the market. Bank of America and PayPal would be an example of deployers, along with eBay, who are using the biometrics embedded in the device. So they're kind of two flavors, two use cases that we're seeing deployed in market. And a lot of these companies are still just supporting one use case or the other. Either FIDO as a second factor, dedicated security key form factor, or FIDO integrated into the biometric capability of a device. And what we would recommend is, you know, if you want the very best experience, you want the
largest number of clients that you can get support for, then you'll want server-side infrastructure that supports both of those use cases. So people can authenticate with their smartphone or their dedicated second-factor devices.
Thank you so much. Deployments have been going on, and there have been some of the leading-edge adopters, such as Google. Really, the question is twofold. From one side, what has been the feedback from the users? Have they been enjoying this experience? Has it been a pleasant experience for them? And also, ultimately, one of the driving forces behind using alternatives to passwords was to reduce the cost of ownership of password resets, account resets. Has that been happening, and what have you seen from that perspective? You can start with Christiaan, Abbie, and Brett, and Will, feel free to add on.
Cool, thanks. Good question. I think I already, you know, saw some of you guys in the audience today when we spoke about, hey, yet another authenticator, another thing to carry around. Everyone's like, here we go again. Firstly, I think one of the things that we wanted to accomplish here was making it really, really easy for the user. I think that's important, right? It's something you carry around. It's a device that's very robust. You plug it in, you press a button, that's it, right? No need for cell connectivity, no text messaging, no retyping of codes, just a simple click with the promise of advanced protection against common threats, not weird threats, things that might happen, like real threats that's really an issue and plaguing the industry today. So I think the ease of use and then the coupling with the advanced protection is kind of the important part, and that's maybe the trade-off there. Hey, maybe I will carry another token or another device if I know it can provide me this elevated level of protection. Of course, that's not the only thing we do. There is many other ways to try and address some of these challenges, but I think a discrete way to do it is through kind of FIDO, or specifically then the use case that we've implemented, the universal second factory use case. But that's not the only thing that we want to do, right? So it's not to say that I have to carry this device. Many of this processing can also technically be done by another device, like a phone, right? So there is no reason why my phone at some point in time can't be the center of kind of my authentication universe. I could use my device to accomplish the same thing. We started somewhere. I think the industry started somewhere. The easiest was to say, hey, we've got this protocol. This protocol is supposed to protect against these couple of threats. When we started, we started from the threat perspective. These are the things we have to solve for. And that was easy to kind of put them all on a whiteboard and kind of take them off one by one. Implementing the protocol was the easiest, to say, hey, let's get a discrete device, let's implement this protocol and make this work. But going forward, we don't have to use a discrete device, right? That's kind of the first step, but there's other ways of trying to solve the problem now that we have the framework and the protocols in place. So I would say, from a consumer perspective, yes, we heard positive things. It's kind of from an ease of use perspective, more so where users are incentivized to use these types of devices because they might fall into a class of users that, you know, might need elevated levels of protection. I can speak to total cost of ownership. We've published a report, actually a paper in Financial Crypto last year, where we looked at Google's deployment over 2 years of FIDO U2F devices internally as our main form of second factor. And one thing that I can absolutely say, and it's pretty evident from the report as well, is our total cost of ownership is down. The number of support incidents is close to zero. These devices are so robust, they're so easy to use, that we just don't have the problems that's associated with multi-factor solutions anymore that we used to have. I mean, we used to do multi-factor authentication before FIDO. We used other pretty popular techniques. They all had their drawbacks. I think we found that from a TCO perspective, we're definitely better off. And you know, user satisfaction is up. It's simple. You plug it in, click the button, and there you go. So I'd say positive. Yeah.
Yeah. So from our end, we have similar conclusions like what Christiaan is saying. The usability studies that we have done so far, those that have done Touch ID or fingerprint on devices, they sailed into the application, no issues whatsoever. Those that refused to use Touch ID from day one, they were the most affected part of the deployment test because they don't want to use that technology. So this is why we are flexible where you can use Ben and others. We don't want to fix a standard way for you to interact with us. We give you the options. And the enrollment within the FIDO type platform, the design was made to be done in the background where you really agree, let's enroll, and I enroll you while you're working within the application without saying I'm enrolling you. So it become much more user friendly. So we spend a lot of time in designing the interface to make it less transparent, okay? So the usability, those that enrolled successfully and start, they love it. You know, it's the way to go. And in terms of support and others, I know we don't have statistical data yet, but I know based on what we have seen that the big selling feature is the reliance on, you know, calling CSR every time there is a problem. And CSR is fraud, is problematic because all what they do is reset your username and password. So if you're trying to hack the system, we give you better opportunity to hack us more. And we don't want to do that, you know. So, you know, FIDO really eliminates a lot of the friction that we had. It's part of the issue that you have to look like, if those that do not want to, with Touch ID, for example, where do we send them? Do we send them to an Aetna site to teach them how to do it or send them to Apple? Stuff like that become technicalities, but, you know, this is what the situation is, you know. We have to learn as we go how to address the exemptions, you know, not the rule. But within Aetna, there is a lot of excitement for this technology. The across all of our businesses, they really look forward to full deployment, you know.
Very it's, good. It's and so, Brent, I'm gonna ask you a final question for me and then open it up for a question and answer session. So, you know, at FIDO, we finally convinced or initiated the process of W3C standardizing FIDO as a mechanism for authentication, both on browsers and for platforms. So I'm a implementer, I want to deploy FIDO, should I wait? What is the suggestion? What does this mean now from a deployer's perspective?
Sure, so you said this is the last question, right? So if anyone does have questions for us, you can go ahead and start queuing up at the mics. So the question's about, you know, the W3C. You know, we partnered with them, we put some specifications in W3C. W3C is not finalized or ratified those web APIs yet. So should you wait for that, or should you be deploying with what we finished and published in 2014? I'll answer that in a way, kind of with a question. So if the problem you're trying to solve is phishing, then by all means, deploy now. Because there is solutions in market that have been deployed at scale with both leveraging the biometric sensors on popular smartphones. There's new capabilities now on a lot of the new line of laptops that where Intel SGX has built FIDO into that. So you got support on desktops now. And you've got the second factor solution with the security key modality. So it's like, depending on what devices you want to support, you deploy now. All you're going to get out of the W3C standardization is more device support. In generally speaking, that's what's happening here. We built specifications that did FIDO authentication for two different modalities, two different specifications. Now we worked with W3C so that FIDO authentication becomes the standardized mechanism for strong auth across the entire web platform. And we anticipate that once we are ratified in the web platform, that operating system platforms will pick it up as well. And Microsoft's already publicly declared they will do so. So it's really a question of how many, you know, what's the device support that you have to do FIDO auth today? Because the use cases are the same. The specifications are going to be a little bit different, but the use cases are the same. You're going to get more devices as all the browsers pick up support and you get platform level support in the operating systems, but you have a lot of support now. Hundreds of millions of smartphones already have FIDO capabilities. Chrome browser already has FIDO capabilities. Android already has FIDO capability for U2F. So it's out there now and the market's just growing. So that's how I would answer the question. It's like, how do you need ubiquitous support on the device side before you deploy? Even if that's your answer, then you might want to look at, all right, well, can you distribute a software authenticator yourself? Because you can reach all the devices, you know, by having your own client on those devices. But most people like add this as an option now, and then over time you'll actually be able to finally deprecate your shared secret authentication credentials.
Thank you so much. With that one, we'll open it up to any questions you may have. There's two mics here. Feel free to ask any questions about the panelists.
Hello. I have two questions for Google in particular. So your Google Authenticator, for example, you have the code out there. If we wanted to, as an enterprise, use that to enable, say, an open source two-factor authentication solution. Do you plan to do something similar with the FIDO standards?
Right. That's a good question. I think Google Authenticator today is kind of the authenticator on the device itself. Today, the deployment that we've done on U2F is based on a discrete hardware, a discrete device being the authenticator. You can go online and search for FIDO U2F and you'll find a couple of vendors making these devices. I think by last count we have over 20 vendors in the FIDO ecosystem making these devices. So I think it's kind of a little bit comparing, like, you know, apples and oranges. On the one side, you know, it would be interesting at some point, I guess, to have the phone itself act as an authenticator in the same space as it's doing today, using shared secrets with Google Authenticator and Oath Authentication, using the phone as a mechanism for providing phishing-resistant logins as well. We haven't completely decided what the next steps are, but I think something like that would make sense going forward. So yeah, it's something that we're definitely looking into.
Okay, thank you. And the second question was related to one of the comments you made about the security key enforcement.
Right.
So is that something you built in-house to manage the security keys? Or would this, do you have recommendations on the key management, for example? How do you manage those keys if you're requiring key enforcement?
Right, that's a great question. So security key enforcement right now is kind of, it's a Google product. So it's something that we launched about 14 days ago for G Suite, previously Google Apps customers. If you're using Google Apps or G Suite as an administrator, you can go in, you can now enforce these. There is management capabilities, there is enrollment capabilities. So all these things kind of bundled underneath a single umbrella called security key enforcement. We don't have, as Google, any best practices available right now for other organizations wanting to do the same thing, except for saying, hey, come to G Suite and come, like, set you up there. We can help you out. But I think that's something in FIDO that we can definitely take a look at as time goes on.
Okay. Yeah, and one of those questions on the keys would be, like, revocation, for example, right. Specifically. Like, how do I kill it when I suspect compromise, and how do
right,
I do it quickly?
Right. That's all available in G Suite today.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. How specific are your deployments right now to U2F and second factor generally, and where do you see UAF and kind of getting to the first factor aspect of things going forward?
Right. Great question. So today, the number one problem, as I said, for our Google consumers is phishing. And that problem really comes into play at the bootstrapping phase. So that's when I try to sign into my Google account the very first time. Google has already kind of moved to a model where it's not so much continuously typing in your password as setting up your device. Think about a phone. I get my new device. I type in my Google credentials once. I probably don't have to type my credentials on that phone ever again. That's where you're vulnerable. It's at the initial bootstrap. So for us, the problem that we want to solve, and again, this is different for other organizations next to me here, but for us specifically, the problem is bootstrap. So we're much more inclined to solve that problem first. Yes, at Google, we have other use cases too. Think of payments, for example. In payments, we do need to keep kind of authenticating the user on a regular basis, but it's a secondary use case to the bootstrapping problem. So as you mentioned, UAF or something UAF-like, the first factor or reauthentication use cases, we call it, is something that's interesting and something that we will definitely take a look at. But I think we are focused right now on the initial bootstrap use case because that's where we think the pain point is.
Yeah, actually, I can add.
Yeah.
And to be honest with you, I'm glad you are, because at the end of the day, we could imagine an ecosystem where I can work with you to attest, because at the end, it's a binding problem. You, some identity and a device, and someone saying, I have seen this combination in a good way before. So if they can do this job, good for you. You know, I don't have to invest in it. You know, I look more at behavior. But the bootstrapping problem become much easier for me if I can be part of an ecosystem where I can get enough information about you as a user or who you claim to be, so I can start to enroll you.
Thanks.
Are you guys experiencing or seeing additional browser adoption for U2F? Today it seems to be limited to Chrome and Opera.
I'm going to leave you on to Brad.
Sure. So Chrome and Opera are confirmed implementations in the wild today supporting U2F. Firefox has an active project of adding U2F, and the Firefox team is very involved in the Web Authent, which is the FIDO standardization effort in W3C. So, you know, you can draw conclusions. I thought maybe Firefox would be U2F compliant by now. For whatever reason, the project isn't done, but they obviously have a very transparent process, and you can see that they are working on it.
I wanted to add that as part of W3C, now that it becomes part of a spec that browsers support day in, day out, then it becomes much more of a broader support from a browser perspective.
Thank you.
So a question for Christian or Brett. Christian, you were talking about in the future you might want to use the mobile phone as your authenticator instead of the physical U2F device. With the standard of U2F, would a mobile phone meet that criteria of being a U2F device for FIDO?
That's a very short answer. The answer is yes, it would. I don't know, Brett, if you want to add anything to that.
So I actually don't want to call them UAF, U2F, because now with the W3C standardization, you've got kind of one spec set. We have something called CTAP. So the FIDO2 project, which is to get both of those use cases previously enabled by UAF and U2F, to have both of those use cases supported by kind of a single set that was designed for platform enablement. That's the summary of what the FIDO2 project's all about. So I will just talk about those use cases. So in the use case where you're on a smartphone, that was motivated by this idea that you want the authenticator to do two jobs. You want it to do user verification. Yes, I have the same user that registered the credential originally. And two, device, you know, what you have authenticator, proof of possession of the private key. So I have both a what you are and a what you have multi-factor authentication event. That's why UAF was written the way it was. So it takes into account that there could be different ways to doing biometric interaction or a PIN number. It's an abstraction layer that isn't there in U2F, because in U2F, the assumption was, I've already identified the account by giving a username and password. Now I just have to do a what you have authentication factor with strong crypto. So as we move forward with the results of the FIDO2 project, between FIDO's CTAP, client to authenticator protocol, and WebAuthn, which is the specification out of W3C, that's going to enable both those use cases. So you can have your smartphone do, so I think Christian's answer of a yes means, well, your smartphone doesn't have to do two jobs. Your smartphone could just do the second job. We haven't seen that in the market. No one's implemented that. They've only implemented the security key form factor for that, you know, what you have authentication factor. But now we might start seeing people play around with both, because between Google and Facebook, Dropbox and Salesforce, there are enough services already that are live for second factor support that maybe it starts making sense for those smartphones to be able to do just the second job for those services that only are looking for that, while they continue to offer multi-factor authentication with both the biometric and the private key.
Okay, because the reason I ask that, in banking a lot of banks are moving away from a physical token to the soft token. They want to get away from something extra you got to carry in your hand. So obviously the phone is something you already have, so I was just that's why I was asking the questions. That was just the background, not for more comment, but just the background of the purpose.
Well,
I
do want to add to that. So the soft token, the problem with soft token approach, right, is the binding of that credential to the device, right? So if a regulator, this is a great opportunity because I want to say something about regulation. Multi-factor authentication is regulated in certain regions and in certain vertical markets. The history of that regulation requires each factor to come from a separate channel, often interpreted as a separate device. We've made a lot of progress in the past year where we're seeing an opportunity to change the way regulators look at that question in Europe around Payment Services Directive 2. Because now they've updated their language to recognize that modern devices actually have multiple environments inside one device. Mm-hmm. So you can actually have separate independent authentication factors not vulnerable to malware by using things like a TEE. And so you can get multi-factor with that tight binding to the hardware, and that's been a FIDO principle all along.
Okay. And NIST has updated the spec to reflect the same principle.
Right, and just in closing, also NIST has had comments about that as well, where the same device done properly
right.
could do that.
And that's what they had in mind when they said done properly.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
last question.
So around the payment part, and I've heard everybody talk about Europe, but nobody's talked about China. How are you guys gonna handle China? I work for a major company that's getting ready to start doing business there. What do I do?
So the government of China is a member of the FIDO Alliance, the standardization body in the government of China. We have a FIDO China working group that's comprised of many Chinese companies as well as Chinese government agencies. The very first accredited certification lab in the world to do FIDO certification is CTTL in China. So we're doing a lot.
I apologize, we're out of time.
We're out of time, but short answer, we're doing a lot in China. We have Chinese companies on the board. There is a special government kind of biometric database system in China that we have to kind of, companies in China need to figure out how do I take my FIDO authenticator and bind it to that other system, but that's all we're really working on there.
I want to thank our panelists and thank you for attending this panel. Thank you. Yeah.